Hello everyone and welcome to my video lecture series. In my previous lecture, we had seen the current status of biodiversity, right? And we had talked about the reasons which are causing loss of biodiversity, right? Today we are going to start with the new part. Okay, it will be more or less concerned with conservation of biodiversity. Okay, before we start with today's part, all those who are watching this video and who have yet not subscribed, kindly do so. Okay, press the subscribe button and also press the bell icon so that you will easily get notified whenever I upload my videos. Anyway, coming back to today's part, the first thing that we are going to study today is about the conservation categories. Okay, we have already studied about IUCN, which is the International Union for Conservation of Nature. Okay, so first thing that we are going to study are the different conservation categories which are listed by IUCN. Okay, and they classify all the animals and plants according to their conservation category. So let us start with that part. Now, IUCN, as we had discussed in the last lecture, it basically classifies the species. Okay, it finds out information regarding all the species, and according to the IUCN 2004 data, there are approximately 1.5 million species present. That is the biodiversity, right? We had done this in the last lecture. Now what happens is IUCN basically concentrates more on the organisms or on the species whose number is dwindling, or on the species whose numbers are decreasing day by day. Okay, because those organisms are of prime focus, so IUCN pays more attention to these organisms. Some of the organisms which are no longer present on the earth, they are classified as extinct, right? So you know that category, and that is called as extinction, right? And the other important category is where the numbers begin to decrease of the species. When the numbers of the species begin to decrease, then IUCN basically puts it in a category which is called as endangered. Is this clear? So these are two very, very important categories, okay, on which IUCN pays a lot of attention. Extinction is basically when all the animals are no longer present, not even a single organism of the given species is present, okay, that is called as extinction. And endangered means day by day the numbers of those species are reducing. For example, let us suppose that tigers initially were having a population of about 60,000 in India. Slowly, right now maybe there are approximately 5,000 or less tigers, so the numbers have continuously decreased, okay, over the years, so they are basically in the endangered category. Are you clear? Okay, now these are not the only two conservation categories which IUCN has made. IUCN has made many other categories. Total there are 9 conservation categories. Please remember this. Okay, and we are going to study about these categories. All right, and these categories are together piled up, and the data is recorded. Okay, and that data which is all recorded and listed, it is called as the Red Data Book, or it is also called as the Red List. So Red List or the Red Data Book of IUCN basically has got the list of all the organisms, okay, which are plants and animals, as which belong to different categories of their conservation. Okay, so all that compilation together is present in the Red Data Book or Red List. So in Red Data Book or Red List, you will find animals and plants which are not harmed at all, their numbers are plentiful, and you will also find animals and plants whose numbers have been decreasing. You will also find animals and plants which have been extinct. So right from the organisms which are not affected at all, whose numbers are quite large, to the organisms who have become extinct, you will find the data of all these organisms in Red Data Book or Red List. And this is compiled by which organization? This data is compiled by the IUCN. So please remember this, very, very important. The total compilation, okay, is called as Red Data Book, or it is also called as the Red List. Okay, so that is what we are going to study. Now coming to the red list or coming to the 9 conservative categories, let us start with the categories. Okay, so the first category that I am going to take into account, okay, is called as NE. Is this clear? And NE basically stands for not evaluated. This is the first conservation category. We are starting with the conservation categories. The first conservation category is not evaluated, which is abbreviated as NE. What is the meaning of not evaluated? See, all the different scientists in the world, they basically make a record of all the organisms which are found, okay? And approximately 1.9 million species are found by the different scientists present throughout the world. But what happens is that some of the organisms, their data is not taken by the IUCN. Okay, IUCN doesn't need their data because those organisms are not in any danger. Okay, so those organisms, okay, they are called as not evaluated. Not evaluated means their evaluation has not been done by IUCN. They are not put under much limelight by the IUCN because their numbers are more than enough. Okay, so they are not under any danger. So these are called as not evaluated. So you will not find much information about these species of plants and animals in the red data book or red list. However, this is one of the conservation categories and that is called as not evaluated. So not evaluated means that the animals and plant species found by the scientists, however, they are not assessed, okay, by IUCN, they are included in this category, which is not evaluated. Okay, coming to the next category after not evaluated, that is called as the DD category, and DD stands for data deficient. Okay, now what is this category? So data deficient means less data is present. So all the organisms or all the species which are present in this category, the IUCN doesn't have much information about them. See, IUCN tries to get information about these organisms which are placed in this category. However, it has not been able to find out much information, and hence this category is called as data deficient. That means not enough data is there about this species. Okay, so we cannot say that how much endangered they are or how safe these species are. So this category is called as data deficient category of conservation, where not much information related to the organisms is there with IUCN. Is this clear? This is called as the data deficient conservation category. The third category, okay, is the LC category, which is also called as the least concern category. See, what is the meaning of least concern? Least concern means there is no issue with this species. Okay, see, the category of LC, okay, all the organism, all the species which are present in least concern category, IUCN has got all records about these species. Okay, it has made in-depth investigations about all these species, and IUCN has come to the conclusion that the population of all the species included in this category, it is more than enough, and it is not going to become extinct anywhere in the near future. The numbers are very, very large. So all the species present in least concern category, okay, you do not need to think about them much. Their numbers are more than enough and they are not decreasing, so they are stable. So all those species are present in the category called as least concern. Is this clear? Okay, now these three categories which we have studied, okay, these are the safe categories of conservation by the IUCN. Okay, all these three categories boast of species whose numbers are more or less stable. Please remember. Okay, now as we proceed ahead, you will come to know that slowly as we move on to the next category, the number of organisms in a given species that will begin to decrease with each category. Is that clear? Okay, next category, which is the fourth one, that is called as the NT category, which means near threatened. Okay, what is the meaning of near threatened? Okay, near threatened category means that there is a chance that the species present over here, they might reduce in number in the given future. See, they are not under threat currently. Okay, near threatened means they are almost threatened. In the future, their numbers might reduce. Okay, so that is why they are kept in this category. Currently, their numbers are not under danger, but in the future, maybe in the given 2 years, 3 years, or 5 years, or even more, their numbers might reduce. So, all the species, okay, whose future is uncertain, they will be put in this category, which is called as near threatened, almost threatened, okay, still not threatened. Is this clear? That is the fourth category. Now, from the fifth category onwards, you will see that the number of species has reduced since the last 10 years. Okay, the next category is called as the VU category, which is also called as the vulnerable category. Now, what is the vulnerable category? The vulnerable conservation category of IUCN basically has got all the species whose numbers have reduced from 30% to 50% in the last 10 years. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to write that down over here in the bracket. Reduction in 30 reduction in population by 30 to 50% in the last 10 years, okay, or you can say in the last 3 generations. So basically, all those species whose numbers have reduced by 30 to 50% in the last 10 years, they are classified in the vulnerable category of conservation. For example, let us take any example. Suppose if there are 1 lakh wolves in the world, I'm just giving you a hypothetical example. If there are 1 lakh wolves, okay, they were 1 lakh 10 years back. Okay, and now the number of wolves are 60,000. That means they have reduced by 40% in the last 10 years. So that is why we will place wolves under the category called as vulnerable. Is this clear? Okay, so this category is where over the last 10 years 30 to 50% of the population has reduced. The next category that we are going to study is called as endangered, which is written as EN. Please remember the abbreviations, okay, because these abbreviations, they can be asked in the exam. Okay, they might not write down the entire word, so please remember these abbreviations. That is why I am writing abbreviations before the actual categories. Now, which species belong to this category? So basically, in the case of these species, the reduction in population is by 50 to 70% in the last 10 years. Okay, so if you compare this category with vulnerable category, then this category is in much more danger compared to the previous one, because here more proportion of the population has declined in the last 10 years. Earlier it was 30 to 50%, now it is 50 to 70%. Okay, so that category is called as endangered. Is this clear? Or over here you can write down 3 generations. Last 10 years or last 3 generations. Is this clear? Next, as we move on further down the category list, the 7th category is called as critically endangered, which is CE. Okay, now which organisms are included in this category? So critically endangered means these organisms are almost close to extinction. Okay, if preventive measures are not taken to stop their reduction in numbers, or proper actions are not taken by human beings so that their numbers do not decrease more, then what will happen is these species will get extinct. So what is critically endangered category? It is the category where not more than 50 organisms belong to the given species, they are present in the world right now. Okay, for example, if I say that a particular turtle is critically endangered, that means only 50 organisms of that turtle or less than 50 organisms of that turtle will be present throughout the world. So they are very, very close to extinction. That is called as critically endangered. So I will write down over here in the bracket numbers. Less than 50 in the world. Is this clear? So throughout the world, just imagine there are only 50 or less than 50 organisms belonging to that species. So their number is very, very less. And if proper action is not taken, these species will become extinct. So that is called as critically endangered category. Now, the next two categories which we are going to study about conservation, they are mostly belonging to the extinction part. So I will write down the eighth one. Okay, the eighth category given by IUCN for conservation is called as EW category, which means extinct in the wild. Now, what do you mean by extinct in the wild? So all the organisms or species which belong to this category, they are not present in the wild. Okay, they are not present in their natural habitat. Okay, in the natural habitat they are extinct. However, if they are captured, okay, or if they are present in a zoo, then they are present. However, in the wild, naturally they are extinct. That is called as extinct in the wild. For example, if an organism or if an animal is in this category of extinct in the wild, that means if you go in its natural habitat, you will not find it anywhere in the world. However, you can find it in a zoo or in some other enclosure where human beings have conserved it. Is that clear? So that is called as extinct in the wild. So I will write down over here. These species are not present in their natural habitat. So where are they present? If at all they are present, they are only present in captivity. Captivity means when human beings have held them captive. Is that clear? Okay. And the last category and the most important category in this entire red list or red data book, that is called as the extinct category. Okay. So extinct is EX. Okay, and everybody knows what this category means. That means that not a single organism belonging to that species is present in wild or in captivity. It is not present anywhere on the earth. That means it is extinct. So I will write it down over here. Okay, species is not present in the wild. In the wild means in the natural habitat and captivity. So it is not present in the wild nor is it present in captivity. So no organism belonging to that species will be present on earth. So these are the nine categories. So I hope you have understood them. Okay, once again, if we look at all the categories, we started with the first category, which is called non-evaluated. Non-evaluated is a category where basically IUCN doesn't access reports regarding these animals because they are plenty in number. So IUCN itself doesn't take information from the scientists regarding that, and they are not assessed or not evaluated. Second is data deficient, where enough data is not present with the IUCN. Okay, and that is why these organisms are placed in this category called DD. Third is least concern, where a lot of data is present regarding this species with IUCN, And IUCN comes to the conclusion that more than enough numbers of these organisms or species are present, so they are not in any danger, so that is the least concern. Okay, from the next category onwards, the number of organisms will decrease. Next is the NT category, near threatened. So these organisms are not in danger currently, but in the future their numbers might reduce. Such organisms are placed in near threatened category. After that, the next category is called as vulnerable category, where the population of the given species has decreased by 30 to 50% in the last 10 years. After that, we come to endangered. In endangered, the population has decreased by 50 to 70% in the last 10 years. After that, we come to critically endangered, where the population has decreased to such an extent that only 50 organisms or less than that are of the species are present in the environment. Is that clear throughout the world? After that, we come to the extinction categories. First is extinct in the wild. That means these organisms are only present or can only be present in captivity, okay, and they are not present in their natural habitat or in the wild. And last is extinct, where they are not present in captivity and they are not present in the wild, so those species are completely dead. Is that clear? So these are the 9 conservation categories given by IUCN, and that compilation is called as what? It is called as Red Data Book or Red List. Is that clear? So that ends the first part of our today's lecture. The next part of today's lecture is going to be, why do we need to conserve biodiversity? What is the need for conservation of biodiversity? So let us move to that part. Okay, I'll just scroll down. Okay, why to conserve biodiversity? Before we come to the question of why do we need to conserve biodiversity, what is the meaning of conservation of biodiversity? See, conservation of biodiversity mainly means that you need to protect, okay, you need to uplift, and you need to scientifically manage the biodiversity so that the optimum level of biodiversity throughout the world is maintained. Okay, and what will happen if the biodiversity is maintained at optimum level? That biodiversity will be used for our sustenance in the present and future. Is this clear? So basically, conservation of biodiversity means to uplift. Uplift means if the biodiversity is decreasing, then you need to increase the biodiversity. Second is to protect. You have to protect the biodiversity from decreasing. And third is using scientific management. So you have to use scientific techniques to keep the optimum levels of biodiversity, and that will help us and the other organisms, okay, in sustenance or to survive. Is that clear? That is called as conservation. Now, why do we need to conserve biodiversity? There are 3 reasons why we need to conserve biodiversity. I am going to state these reasons right now. Okay, reason number 1 is called as narrow utilitarian reasons. Reason number 2, I am going to explain all these reasons, don't worry. Second is called as broad utilitarian reasons. And the third is called as ethical reasons. Okay, now these are the 3 reasons why we need to conserve biodiversity. Now if I ask you, why do we need to conserve biodiversity? Then first of all, as humans, we will think about ourselves, right? Because we are always the most selfish of all the organisms, right? We may be intellectually much more developed compared to all organisms, so we always think about us first. So coming to the first reason, which is called as the narrow utilitarian region, okay? I can also write it as narrowly utilitarian reason. So narrowly utilitarian reason means the only thinking about ourselves, okay, how the biodiversity is going to be important for us, right? Then how is it important to protect? Why is it important to protect biodiversity? See, first of all, food, clothing, shelter, all that we are getting from the nature. So let me write it down, okay. let me just scroll this sideways. So food, clothing, all right, shelter, all these things we are getting from the nature. Okay, the biodiversity, the animals, plants, all other organisms are providing us with this. Then what else do we get? Even ornaments, if you want. So I will write it down over here, ornaments. Okay, apart from that, many animals and plants are used as source of medicine. Okay, and please remember, in the medicine industry, 20% of medicine comes from animal and plant sources. So it is a huge economic sector. So also for the medicine industry, okay, so we are getting basically medicines from biodiversity. What else is it helping us in? We are getting many other important products. We are getting secondary metabolites, for example, resins, tannins. Okay, so I will write it down over here. Resins, or you can write down rubber, or you can write down tannins. So all these things we are getting from the nature, or we are getting from the biodiversity. And if we do not conserve biodiversity, then we will stop getting all these things, right? And if we do not get all these things, human beings themselves will become extinct. So from the selfish point of view, when we only think about ourselves, from that point of view also, it is very, very important to conserve biodiversity. And that is called as the narrowly utilitarian reason. Is that clear? Okay, and for that reason, nowadays bio prospecting is also done. I will write down this term over here, bio prospecting. What is the meaning of bio prospecting? See, bio prospecting means basically we are using the bio resources, or we are using the biodiversity resources like plants and animals, and we are trying to obtain new products from these plants and animals. Okay, so that from these obtained products we can create organic compounds, chemical compounds, microorganisms, macroorganisms, genes. Okay, so basically what we are trying to do is we are trying to find out an alternative to these resources when they become less. So that is called as bioprospecting. Is this clear? So bioprospecting means that we are using the natural resources, the bio resources, to find out products, and from those products we are going to make things which are important for our sustenance. That is called as bioprospecting. Okay, so that ends our first reason why we need to conserve biodiversity, and that is only from the narrow point of view, from the selfish point of view. That is why it is called as narrowly utilitarian reason. See, if we want to talk about a person who is selfish, we normally use the term that that person is narrow-minded. That means he's only thinking about himself or herself. Is that clear? So that is called as narrowly utilitarian reason. Next is the broad utilitarian reason. Now, what is the meaning of broadly utilitarian reason? Now, over here, we are thinking that already the nature is providing us with so many things. So, in return, it is our duty to protect the nature or protect the biodiversity. For example, the oxygen that is present in the atmosphere, okay, almost 20% of that oxygen comes from the Amazon rainforest. Okay, and oxygen is obviously very, very important for survival. Everybody knows that. So the nature is providing us with oxygen, or you can say that biodiversity is providing us with oxygen. The second thing is pollination is done by many animals or many organisms. Okay, similarly, dispersal of seeds, spreading of seeds, so that those seeds will germinate and grow into new plants. All this is done by many different organisms. So because of all these things which are happening in nature, we are getting benefited. So in turn, we also have to conserve biodiversity. So that is called as the broad utilitarian approach or broad utilitarian reason, where we don't only think about ourselves, but we have to give something back to the biodiversity. And that is why we have to conserve it. Are you getting the difference between narrow utilitarian reason and broad utilitarian reason? In narrow utilitarian reason, we are only thinking about how biodiversity is important to us. That is called as the selfish approach. Whereas in the broad utilitarian reason, we are thinking about how we can give back to biodiversity for whatever it has done for us. Okay. Now, in 2019, in the month of August, there were fires, forest fires in the Amazon tropical rainforest, and because of that, almost 9 lakh hectares of forest area was destroyed. Also, please remember, most of these forest fires, they were caused in Brazil, and they are caused due to slash and burn method of agriculture. Now, what is slash and burn? So, I will write it down over here. Slash and burn. You might have heard of this term. So, slash and burn agriculture is basically where the trees in the forest are cut down. Okay. And then all those cut trees are burnt so that that area becomes empty. And in that empty area, people basically produce crops, they grow agriculture, okay? So that is called as slash and burn. Now, how is this destroying biodiversity? You are basically destroying the forest. Now, what is going to happen is, after some time, the crops will not grow in that region. Why? Because all the nutrients in the soil will be depleted. So then what will happen? Then the crops will also die, and anyway the trees have been cut and burned, so that area will become barren. So that is called as slash and burn technique. And because of this slash and burn technique, sometimes the burning is not controlled and can lead to forest fires. And because of that also, the forest fire in Amazon, this can be one of the reasons for that. Is that clear? But because of that, a lot of loss in Amazon rainforest had occurred in August. Okay. And so we need to take into account this approach, that whatever nature is doing for us, we have to do something in return. Okay, it will benefit us and it will benefit all the other living organisms. So this approach, or this reason for conserving biodiversity, is called as the broadly utilitarian reason. See, if we talk about a selfish person, we call him or her as narrow-minded. However, if we are talking about a person who thinks about others, we call that person as a person who is having broad-minded mentality. That means he or she thinks about everybody else and not only himself or herself. Is that clear? And the last reason for conservation of biodiversity is the ethical reason. See, what is the meaning of ethics? Ethics means doing what is right and not doing what is wrong. That is called as ethics. Okay, that is also called as moral. For example, over here we can give the reason that along with human beings, there are many other living organisms, right? And all these organisms have equal right to survive, and they have an equal right to get the benefits of the nature. Then why is only man getting most of the benefits of the environment? Okay, and why is man only using environment according to his selfish needs? Because of that, what is happening is the other species are getting destroyed. So that is not ethically correct, because according to ethics, each organism has the right to survive, each organism has the right to reproduce, and each organism has the right to basically reap the benefits of the environment. Okay, and according to ethical reasons, we cannot basically ever over exploit the resources of the biosphere or the environment and reduce the biodiversity. So that is called as ethical reasons. Is this clear? So these are basically the three reasons why we should conserve biodiversity. So I hope the concepts are clear. Again, this entire lecture is very, very theoretical. Okay, this part you can actually understand it as a concept. Okay, the first reason for conservation was from the selfish point of view. It is also called as the narrowly utilitarian reason. Okay, so in that you have to write about how biodiversity is giving so many things to us. For example, food, clothing, shelter, ornament, medicines, okay, and how we are doing bioprospecting, where we are trying to find out new products from the available resources so that we can produce new things like macromolecules, okay, microorganisms, macroorganisms, organic chemical compounds, genes, all those things. Then we start thinking about others. So that is called as the broadly utilitarian reason, where we have to pay back, okay, for all the things that the biodiversity or the nature has done for us. We have to give something back in return. What do we have to write over there? So first of all, give that example of oxygen. See, an oxygen cylinder, if you go and buy in the market, it is very costly. but the same thing is provided to you, okay, without any cost by nature. That is the first thing. Second is Amazon rainforest contribute to 20% of the total oxygen in atmosphere. Third is many organisms help in pollination, dispersal of seeds and many other activities which are beneficial for mankind. So in return, it is our duty to protect the biodiversity. That is called as the broad approach or broad utilitarian approach. Third is the ethical reasoning. Ethical reasoning means all organisms have equal right to enjoy the environment and to survive, and using that approach we have no right to over exploit or overuse the resources which are present, okay, and by that we can conserve biodiversity. So with that we end our today's lecture. Okay, if you like the lecture, do put in a like, okay, do leave in a comment. If you have still not subscribed to my channel, do subscribe, press the bell icon, share it with your friends, okay, and that's it. Thanks a lot.